The bulk of the mine specification is concerned with the definition of a variety of content types. This reflects the need to provide standardized ways of dealing with a wide variety of information representations in a multimedia environment. The table here lists the content types specified in RFC 2046. There are 7 different major types of content and a total of 15 subtypes in full meaning of the text aside from support of the indicated character set. The primary subtype is plain text, which is simply a string of ASCII characters or ISO 8859 characters. The enriched subtype allows greater formatting flexibility. The multi-part type indicates that the body contains multiple independent parts. The content type header field includes a parameter called a boundary that defines the delimiter between the body parts. This boundary should not appear in any parts of the message. Each boundary starts on a new line and consists of 2 hyphens followed by the boundary value. The final boundary, which indicates the end of the last path, also has a suffix of 2 hyphens. Within each part, there may be an optional ordinary MIME header. There are 4 subtypes of multi-part type, all of which have the same overall syntax. The multi-part mixed subtype is used when there are multiple independent body parts that need to be bundled in a particular order. For the multipart parallel subtype, the order of the part is not significant. If the recipient system is appropriate, the multiple parts can be represented in parallel. For example, a picture or a text part could be accompanied by a voice commentary that is played while the picture or the text is displayed. For the multi-part alternative subtype, the various parts are different representations of the same information. The multi-part digest subtype is used when each of the body parts is interpreted as an RFC 5322 message with headers. This subtype enables the construction of a message whose parts are individual messages. For example, the moderator of a group might collect the email messages from the participants, bundle these messages, and send them out in one encapsulating MIME message. The message type provides a number of important capabilities in MIME. The message RFC 822 subtype indicates that the body is an entire message or a partial subtype, including header and body. Despite the name of this subtype, the encapsulated message may be not only a simple RFC 5322 message, but also any MIME message. The message or partial subtype enables the fragmentation of a large message into a number of parts, which must be reassembled at the destination. For this subtype, 3 parameters are specified in the content type. Message partial field, an ID common to all fragments of the same message, a sequence number unique to each fragment, and the total number of fragments. The message external body subtype indicates that the actual data to be conveyed in this message are not contained in the body. Instead, the body contains the information needed to access the data. As with the other message types, the message external body subtype has an outer header and an encapsulated message with its own header. The only necessary field in the outer header is the content type field, which identifies this is a message external body subtype. The inner header is the message header for encapsulated message. The content type field in the outer header must include an access type parameter, which indicates the method of access, such as FTP, that is the file transfer protocol. The application type refers to other kinds of data, typically either uninterrupted binary data or information to be processed by a mail-based application. The other major component of the MIME specification, in addition to the content type specification, is a definition of transfer encodings for message bodies. The objective is to provide reliable delivery across the largest range of environments. The MIME standard defines two methods of encoding data. The content transfer encoding field can actually take on six values, as listed in the table shown here. However, three of these values, that is 7-bit, 8-bit, and binary, indicates that no encoding has been done, but provide some information about the nature of the data. For SMTP transfer, it is safe to use the 7-bit form. The 8-bit and binary forms may be usable in other mail transport contexts. Another content transfer encoding value is X-token, which indicates that some other encoding scheme is used for which a name is to be supplied. This could be a vendor-specific or application scheme-specific. The two actual encoding schemes defined are coded, printable, and BASE64. Two schemes are defined to provide a choice between a transfer technique that is essentially human-readable and one that is safe for all types of data in a way that is reasonably compact. The coded printable transfer encoding is usually when the data consists largely of octets that correspond to printable ASCII characters. In essence, it represents non-safe characters by hexadecimal representation of their code and introduces reversible line breaks to limit message lengths to 76 characters. The BASE64 transfer encoding, also known as RADIC64 encoding, is a common one for encoding arbitrary binary data in such a way as to be invulnerable to processing by mail transport programs. The MIME multipart example. The figure here, which is taken from RFC2045, is the outline of a complex multipart message. The message has five parts to be displayed serially: two introductory plain text parts, an embedded multipart message, a rich text part, and a closing encapsulated text message in a non-ASCII character set. The embedded multipart message has two parts to be displayed in parallel: a picture and an audio fragment. An important concept in MIME and SMIME is that of canonical form. Canonical form is a format appropriate to the content type that is standardized for use between systems. This is in contrast to the native form, which is a format that may be peculiar to a particular system. The table here is from RFC2049 should help to clarify this matter. In terms of general functionality, SMIME is very similar to PGP. Both offer the ability to sign and or encrypt the messages. In this subsection, we briefly summarize SMIME capability. We then look in more detail at this capability by examining message formats and message preparation. SMIME provides the following functions. Envelope data. This consists of encrypted content of any type and encrypted content encryption keys for one or more recipients. the data. A digital signature is formed by taking the message digest of the content to be signed and then encrypting that with the private key of the signer. The content plus signature are then encoded using the BASE64 encoding. A signed data message can only be viewed by a recipient with S/MIME capability. Clear signed data. As with the signed data, a digital signature of the content is formed. However, in this case, only the digital signature is encoded using BASE64. As a result, recipients without S/MIME capability can view the message content, although they cannot verify the signature. Signed and enveloped data. Signed only and encrypted only entities may be nested so that encrypted data may be signed and signed data or clear signed data may be encrypted.